criteria there. But anyway, I'm very pleased to introduce this panel on Sheridan from Robert Jones and Martin Powell, who, as many of you will already know, have are the recipients of a Leverhulme, a major Leverhulme grant to produce a very large edition of Sheridan's political speeches. So I'll introduce Robert first, who's speaking now, and he'll be giving a general overview of the project and then I think talking about how you might approach the editing of a particular speech. Robert, of course, is an alumnus of Kext, did his PhD here at Kext, and has written widely on literature, gender, and war, performance, politics. And I think it's also as part of this project we're hoping to write a full-length book study of Sheridan politics and performance that is part of the project. And I'll just introduce Martin now while we're here. And Martin, who I know from Irish history circles and is Professor of History at Aberystwyth and has published widely on Irish political culture, material culture, the politics of consumption, toasting, as we know from his references to dry toasting yesterday.
And my least favourite kind.
Yeah, mine also, yeah. And is continuing to publish and research 18th century Irish club and associational life. So Martin's going to be talking after Robert about some of the challenges of editing the speeches of Sheridan that weren't actually presented in Parliament. But I'll hand it over to Robert.
Okay, thank you very much. Sheridan remains best known as the author of The Rivals and the School for Scandal, but his political reputation, as in his own day, has proved rather more difficult to preserve. He has come to seem rather disreputable, part of the louche culture of the late 18th century. The charges against him, that he borrowed dishonestly and spent freely, that he was unfaithful to his wife, that he boozed and caroused, flirted and dangled, cannot easily be denied. Other crimes and misdemeanours litter his career, not least of which is his close relationship to the Prince of Wales. Sheridan was associated with the Prince long before the delinquencies of the Regency. He had defended, advised and counselled him. Consequently, the politician was lost in the courtier. His status as a dubious and enlightened literary figure seems almost celebrated in modern Westminster. Sheridan lies in the Abbey, not near Fox or indeed any other politician, but in Poets' Corner, next to Charles Dickens, who is sometimes claimed as his grandson. In the House of Commons, yeah, not very convincingly, nonetheless, a lot of the biographies that came out in 2012 suggested that Dickens could be best explained by as having Sheridan as his grandfather. Well, over the way, in the House of Commons, Sheridan's portrait, a fine canvas by Sir Joshua Reynolds, hangs in the members' tea room, but does so next near that of John Wilkes, making it a rather disreputable corner of the room. Our project challenges these reputational problems, and our founding assumption, not taken lightly but held nonetheless, is that Sheridan was a serious, thoughtful and important politician. He was, after all, a Member of Parliament for over 30 years, primarily for Stafford, twice serving in government. He was furthermore committed to responsible rule in Ireland and in India, and was an advocate of reform in government, elections and an advocate of the freedom of the press. It's not only what he said, but how he said it that made Sheridan important. Sheridan was a renowned speaker and a noted political performer. His speeches were widely reported. Newspapers regularly printed lengthy extracts from his speeches, aware that his verbal skills and political acuity made for good copy. Sheridan was therefore prominent not only in Parliament, but on the pages of the morning and evening papers. He was, in consequence, among the most notable speakers of his day, a significant opposition voice and a figure through which contemporaries made sense of the political scene. Sheridan was also the Foxite Whigs' chief propagandist and political operator, a manipulator of the press and sometime controller of radicals, rascals and mavericks. More than any other Foxite, Sheridan connected the elite political world with the culture of reform and radical protest. As an elected MP, as the co-owner of Drury Lane Theatre, and as coordinator of the Whig's political and press activities, Sheridan reached several different audiences. His wide contribution has been explored in a number of recent studies, mostly written by people in this room. We should examine the interconnections between the different areas of his political and creative life, so that such the study of high politics has been reanimated and a surprising cross-fertilisation between the legacies of Lewis Nania and Raymond Williams inaugurated. The bicentenary of his death in July 2016 is an appropriate date on which to begin a major project on Sheridan. And we, what, at the heart of it, as Katrina has suggested, or accurately suggested as it turned out, is a new edition of the political works. And the new edition, which I'm going to try and talk about in general terms, some of its problems this morning, is a wonderful opportunity, but presents a number of quite serious challenges. Parliamentary reporting, as most of us know, was in its infancy in Sheridan's day. Shorthand writers, mostly working furtively, took down speeches rapidly. Compression, selection, standardisation, as well as other acts of scribal adjustment were common. Only rarely were speakers given the opportunity to correct their speeches before they appeared in print. Though significant speeches by celebrated orators, Sheridan included, might appear in print editions, though this was much less common. Daunted by these difficulties, critical and textual study of Sheridan's parliamentary work has been limited. Scholars examining his political career have returned inevitably to the text of his speeches provided in the 1816 volume, Speeches of the Late Right Honourable Richard Brinsley Sheridan, several corrected by himself and edited by a constitutional friend. The claim that Sheridan corrected speeches is impossible to verify, but cannot entirely be ignored. Equally, the identity of the constitutional friend remains unknown. Whoever produced these volumes was sympathetic to Sheridan and undertook their work mindful of the need to secure his reputation. Speeches provide a very favourable and generous presentation of Sheridan, including an array of his parliamentary speeches, a fulsome memoir, and some commemorative poems by Moore and by Byron. I tried last year to try and work out who the constitutional friend was by looking at those poems. I was unable to reveal that it wasn't Byron. It almost certainly wasn't Lady Caroline Lamb, or indeed any other member of the Lamb family, but more interestingly, wasn't Thomas Moore. It's the Byron poem that's slightly eccentric. It's a particular edited version of the Byron poem that's circulated in the newspapers, but is not that or the authorised edition that Byron released in August, September of 1816. I didn't really get anywhere with it. There are distinct limits to speeches. Published only weeks after Sheridan's death, it is a hasty production, probably descended from a single published source, the Parliamentary Register. The Parliamentary Register, unfortunately, is not itself entirely reliable, as it is derived from only a few newspaper sources, and of course, omits all of Sheridan's non-parliamentary speeches, a group which we suspect is a key aspect of Sheridan's career. Even so, speeches provide a wide selection of his parliamentary speeches, including some of the extremely short interventions made in direct response to debate in the chamber. For example, Speeches records that on the 11th of April 1790, Sheridan intervened in a finance debate and gave the following speech, which I'll now quote entire. Mr. Sheridan objected to the mode of appointing the finance committee as putting it in the power of ministers to procure many of his own friends to decide on the truth of his own statements. Such interventions enable an assessment of Sheridan as a vocal, observant, participant MP, but they've become inevitably fatiguing and critical addition, not least because the apparatus required to explain them would be wholly disproportionate. Despite its apparent inclusiveness, however, Speeches is not a complete record of Sheridan's parliamentary speeches, omissing speeches found easily in the press. More surprisingly, speeches contained none of the speeches Sheridan gave between 1808 and 1811, the last years of his career, not excepting his bravura performance on press freedom on the 6th of February 1810. Another striking absence is Sheridan's speech of 20th of April 1798, in which he ended his opposition to war with France. A speech printed in most newspapers, animating public opinion and quite possibly influencing Coleridge's fears in solitude. So in response to the eccentricities and limits of speech and our desire to see Sheridan's political works as much wider and certainly reaching beyond Parliament, our edition will include a much wider range of speeches and political writings, reclaiming many speeches not found in the current edition. This new material will include extra parliamentary speeches, such as those made to electors in Stafford and Westminster, as well as to reform groups. Records of election addresses and other extra parliamentary speeches are little known and less studied. Their inclusion in the proposed edition is a unique aspect of the project. This greater range will allow readers to appreciate fully Sheridan's political significance and his contribution to British politics. What's interesting about Sheridan's constituency of Stafford is it exists today pretty much unchanged. One of its claims to fame is its decision not to elect David Cameron in 1997. so there's actually quite an interesting, the persistence of that constituency, while it does say a lot about the relative decline of Stafford as an area of importance, is a great opportunity for us. To give the volumes structure and coherence, we're going to have to be judicious with regard to Sheridan's shorter interventions. And this is perhaps one of the most vexed aspects of the edition. It will be necessary to, we suspect, exclude some speeches or interventions, as I'm calling them, like the one I quoted, entirely. And specifically included might be interventions that relate only to parliamentary etiquette or procedure. Sheridan's intervention, as I said, the matter of the Finance Committee can serve as an illustration. We might also need to exclude occasions when Sheridan spoke only in support of a case already well made by a colleague, or to simply reiterate a long-standing principle of opposition. Though there is, as we've heard this morning, it's much to be said for the force of repetition and how repetition might function to create knowledge by the own power of that repetition. The editors of Burke's writings and speeches reserved their energies for his most important interventions, but they didn't quite concede that. Their task was made more straightforward by Burke's willingness to publish his own speeches. But Burke spoke far more often than writings and speeches suggest, and we will aim to be more candid in this respect, including all occasions when Sheridan spoke in an appendix, even if we don't include the speech as such. The decision to include a speech, hence subjecting it to editorial principles and procedures, will be determined by the level of its contribution it makes to any of the following: the development of Sheridan's political opinions, the agenda of the Whig Party, or a change of position, Sheridan's part or that of his party. Weight will be given to occasions when Sheridan initiated a debate or provided the first or primary response of his party. Some of this will hinge on how many extra speeches we discover. There are a lot in the 1816 editions. It's not the tip of an iceberg. The iceberg isn't that, there isn't probably that much under the water, but there's a lot. And there's also our desire to give Sheridan a sense of seriousness and importance does require some selection. I'm conceding, a vexatious part of the project. Where Sheridan speaks most often is during the 1790s, when more senior Foxites withdrew from Parliament, leaving Sheridan more or less alone in the Commons. An additional criteria will be speeches that are recorded in newspapers or graphic satires, and which consequently gain a wider importance due to the extent of their transmission. In February 1783, for example, Sheridan made a well-recorded intervention in the debate on the preliminary articles of peace between Great Britain, France and Spain, the treaty that would eventually conclude the war for American independence. This speech self-evidently merits inclusion as an important contribution to a national debate. However, Sheridan spoke a second time after he'd been abused by Pitt, who had alluded to his connections to the stage. In a calculated reply, Sheridan likened Pitt to the angry boy in The Alchemist. Nothing is added to the debate by this event intervention, and it's quite easy to see how it might be quite speedily footnoted, but it is significant because the tag stuck to Pitt for the rest of his life, shaping the way in which he was caricatured, and it's also a fine example of Sheridan's quite destructive wit. These selection criteria, together with the exclusion of what I'm calling shorter interventions, will allow the edition to comprise, we think, four thematically arranged volumes: government, reform and finance, colonial wars and imperial governance, although we have the Warren Hastings trial in it, Ireland, America, a third volume on the French Revolution and wars with France, and a fourth volume on parliamentary speeches and Sheridan's other political writing. There's some journalism, there's also some drafts of responses to Johnson and an essay on absentees. These volumes will bring together Sheridan's most persistent political concerns, provide a clear indication of the breadth of his interest. For all the problems it presents, speeches will serve as a copy text for the majority of Sheridan's speeches, but will be collated with the Parliamentary Register and the Parliamentary History as a matter of course. Other sources will require our attention. Although various printings of speeches exist, as well as some manuscripts, the most likely source for entire speeches, variant readings and reports of speeches are newspapers, either directly via the Parliamentary Register or Parliamentary History. And this in itself represents a serious challenge. The majority of newspaper reports are transcriptions of speech hastily printed, with different papers recording different parts of any given speech. Variants and indeed different versions abound. Determining authority will be difficult, though particular attention paid to titles such as the Morning Herald or the Morning Post, with which Sheridan retained a close relationship and to which he may have supplied copies of his speeches. Where a good text exists in the first person, we will probably prefer that version. Sheridan undoubtedly spoke in the first person, and speeches which retain the pronoun have a directness not consistently retained in speeches or elsewhere. New digital technologies, of course, would enable us to present all the different versions of the text, allowing the reader to sift between them. This inclusive approach, to put it generously, has some value, but the purpose of our edition is not to display all the possible permutations, but to provide a reasonable version. We aren't, however, going to apply what used to be called an eclectic version of the text, because that's really a travesty of the source material, and also determining any final best reading would prove, I think, entirely problematic. Our critical and textual apparatus will have to be extensive, however. And to give it, I have edited one significant speech so far, which is the speech I've already alluded to on the 20th of April, 1798. It's not in speeches, interestingly, but it's also one of Sheridan's best and most often printed performances. The different versions of the speech raise some important textual and editorial issues. So just to introduce that speech. By the spring of 1798, Pitt's ministry had been alerted to military preparations across the Channel that indicated an intention on the part of the French Republic to launch an attack on Britain's shores. Although measures were already in place along the south coast to resist French forces when they came, Henry Dundas, as Secretary of State for War, had introduced a bill to enable His Majesty more effectively to provide for the defence of the realm during the present war. The bill had passed with little opposition, becoming law in early April. On the 20th of April, Dundas returned to Parliament with a message from the King. His Majesty thinks it proper to acquaint the House of Commons that from various advices received by His Majesty, it appears that preparations for the embarkation of troops and warlike stores are now carried on with considerable and increased activity. With the avowed design of attempting the invasion of His Majesty's dominions, and that in this design the enemy is encouraged by the correspondence of traitorous and disaffected persons and societies in these kingdoms. The King's message further required the Commons to consider without delay any such further measures as may enable His Majesty to defeat the wicked machinations disaffected persons. The debate would end with a vote on the continued suspension of habeas corpus, which Sheridan and only four others would oppose. Prior to the debate, the opposition had been attacked for what seemed to be their reluctance to support the Crown in the hour of the nation's direst need. Fox had mostly seceded from Parliament, leaving Sheridan pretty much alone. He was therefore under great pressure, but given wide licence when he responded to Dundas. His speech negotiates difficult terrain, pulling no punches when it comes to attacking the ministry, yet Sheridan presented himself, and by implication his party, as firm supporters, now advocates, of war with France. No friends are abandoned. There is no call for reform to be sidelined, but Sheridan shatters the assumption that sympathy for French idealism or opposition to the British government provides sufficient grounds for opposing war. War has become necessary, he proclaims, and opposition without active resistance to invasion, foolish in the extreme. Sheridan nonetheless insisted that he was not against republics, just the Republic of France, nor was he against personalities, save for the characters of the present administration. His ability to hold these imperatives together, while not forsaking his earlier commitments, grants the speech its merited place among his finest rhetorical and political achievements. Newspapers, including the Morning Chronicle and the Star, carried Sheridan's speech at length and in the first person. Other reports of his performance, representing the substance, if not entirely the style of his speech, appeared in the Loyalist, True Britain, as well as the Oracle and the Times. Many of the newspaper reports vary, with some versions emphasising Sheridan's proposals for the defence of the nation, while others intensify his patriotic rhetoric. The speech was subsequently printed as the speech of Mr. Sheridan on the motion to address His Majesty on the present alarming state of affairs. The production of that text indicating the importance and indeed marketability of Sheridan's intervention. Though in the case of the print edition, it was with Sheridan's more anti-ministerial sentiments either removed or toned down. Although it is not included in speeches, the performance appears in both the Parliamentary History and the Parliamentary Register. The latter has some claim to be taken as the copy text, as it is extensive and detailed in its account, containing some phrasings not found elsewhere. However, a superior version, in our view, is found in the Morning Post, and we take that as our copy text for this speech. This version captures best Sheridan's complex and nuanced articulation of his position. It is more clearly a literary endeavour, too. Rhetorical devices, allusion, and alliteration all play a part. It is also in the first person. The Morning Post version also concludes with a paragraph on Irish affairs. The government, he contends, stands to lose the hearts and minds of the Irish. While obviously not connected to the invasion scare, this point clearly mattered enough to Sheridan for him to enunciate it. By 1798, the Morning Post returned to supporting the Foxites, making it the logical choice had Sheridan, as he may have, supplied a copy of his speech. He was certainly contributing to the paper at this time and would have found a sympathetic editor in Daniel Stewart. The Post, moreover, was keen to capture the inherent theatricality of the occasion. Reaction in the chambers recorded, mostly as a universal cry of hear, hear, and as applause. This journal seems to also to influenced other publications, including provincial iterations of it, such as in Felix Farley's journal, Bristol Journal. There are good reasons in the absence of an incontrovertibly authoritative text or personal memo for selecting this version. However, the selection is not uncomplicated. The Morning Post text has some significant omissions and requires lengthy multiple footnotes in order to make sense of what Sheridan was claiming, and indeed what he actually said. Other accounts contain important information, some of which provides extra glosses on what Sheridan said, while others effect a change in his meaning. For example, the Oracle offers a number of different readings for key parts of the speech. The first of several comes right at the beginning. The King's address had required action against traitorous and disaffected persons. In the Morning Post account, Sheridan does not oppose this request. The Oracle noted, however, that he did not oppose it because it conferred not the least additional powers on the Crown, which was already armed with necessary and unlimited authority over the persons of the people. This rather well calibrated attitude is only implied in the play. So Sheridan is trying to say that there's nothing new being proposed here. It's a kind of it's a way of accepting it and denying its significance at the same time. Later, the Oracle has Sheridan claim that he does not doubt that the first drop of English blood spilt on our coast by an invading enemy would raise a valorous fury which could not fail speedily to overwhelm him with destruction. The independence of this country and its posture as a proud nation must be maintained, or every man in it perish. This would be the sentiment under any circumstances, but there never was a period when the success of a French invasion would more infallibly tend to a total misery and ruin. Such universal desolation and even annihilation did they intend. The Morning Post records the sentiment well enough. Sheridan, in this back version, says, "I do not concede that there was ever a period of our history in which the conquest of the kingdom by a foreign power would bring such total ruin as the conquest of Great Britain by the present French Republic." But not quite the sound and the fury, not all that blood and battle that's recorded in the Oracle. The speech is consequently, in some measure, recast by the Post as a less furious exercise in patriotic sabre waving. He sounds a lot less like Burke, in fact, in the Morning Post, which is invariably a good thing. The account in the True Britain, as we might expect, which differs markedly in word choice, in fact, they only coincide in some passage where a cliche is produced, makes Sheridan even more strongly worded recommendations about improving the militia deployment and recruiting more people. That's made even more prominent. As you might expect in a Lawless production, there's also a lot more blood and boiling ferment in it. Taken together and allowing for many other variations, there is a serious task to be undertaken in editing Sheridan, but it is, as I hope you'll be, worth attempting, because Sheridan is an important opposition voice, a gifted orator, as that speech makes clear, and a rival to the acclamation of Burke. But a nice little issue to end with is that in virtually all the versions of the speech, Bonaparte's name, who's the general tasked with the invasion, is spelt in the Italianate way of Buonaparte. And we're pretty sure we're going to standardise spelling and modernise it, because that we're going to have a search function for the online version, not modernising whether you've got. There's not much sense in defending spelling musket with a Q, which, for example, spelling Bonaparte as Buonaparte is suggestive of pronunciation. It has meaning of articulating Napoleon as Corsican, as a reprobate. This implication of a kind of Italian effeminacy. The other example would be the other ruler of France, King Louis, as he's always referred to, and whether to modernise the spelling of Louis's name into Louis. Well, of course we're going to do that, but it seems to no one in 18th century England could bring themselves to say Louis. And you know, did everyone in the Commons talk about Lewis? Who can say? But anyway, thank you very much.
Slightly alarming after having done probably only 4 or 5 months of work on, I suppose, not only speeches beyond Parliament, but certainly beyond the 1816 edition. I think there's an indication that rather than the 4 volumes contracted to OUP, we're going to need another 4 again, because there is a lot of material missing from the 1816 edition. On 1st of October 1798, James Gilray published the caricature Evidence to Character, being a portrait of a traitor by his friends and by himself. It followed the decision of a number of United Irishmen to confess their involvement in the organisation and planned rebellion in return for more lenient sentences. One of the prisoners involved was Arthur O'Connor, senior United Irishman, editor of the Radical Press newspaper. The newspaper is called The Press, and friend and acquaintance of a number of Foxite Whigs. During the trial held in Maidstone, Sheridan had been one of the Foxites who was called to testify as a character witness on behalf of O'Connor. In Gilray's caricature, he comically juxtaposes O'Connor's confession with earnest expressions of faith in O'Connor. Sheridan says, I know him intimately, I treated him and he treated me with confidence, and I swear that I've never met with any man so determined against encouraging French assistance. It's an intrinsically interesting moment in Sheridan's career, and as with Fox, and it's part of broader speculation around how much these senior Foxites knew about the United Irishmen's plans. And I'm sure many of you have read Fintan O'Toole's biography of Sheridan. O'Toole comes down hard on the Sheridan is in the know side of the question. To quote, O'Connor was probably guilty of very serious offences, and Sheridan knew this, O'Toole says. He's building on commentary, for the most part, from the early United Irish historian writing in the early 19th century, R.R. Madden. As with Fox, Sheridan had spent time with O'Connor in London in February 1798, and he also knew, to a greater or lesser degree, two of the other individuals arrested with O'Connor, John Binns, it looks as if they met at a political meeting, and James Coigley. He was in possession of a pamphlet that was inscribed by Coigley, so that particular connection is less certain. It was this caricature that came to mind in thinking about ways in which we might approach Sheridan's political speeches that were not made in Parliament, and thus much less easily found. It's something that we've pledged to do in our project, as Robert says, ensuring that we're embracing the broader public sphere in our approach to Sheridan. So what else might we include? Press writings, where identifiable, speeches made in clubs and societies, speeches made in his parliamentary constituencies. All of these seem pretty obvious, and I'll go on to some of those later. Testimony made in a court during a trial for seditious libel seems much less obvious, and I'm not saying that this would go into our speeches. It might be part of the ephemera that plays a role in our broader project website. But I think in terms of ways in which we're thinking about speeches and Sheridan in particular, I think the political content here is important. And this is the substance, that's the bigger picture of the speech bubble, and this is the Dublin published account of Sheridan's testimony. I've known Mr. O'Connor these 3 years past, and have frequently seen him since. I never met him in any company but that of the respectable gentleman of opposition with whom I associated. And from the opinion I had of his principles, I always conversed with him on political subjects without any reserve. His character was remarkable for its openness. He conversed on the politics relating to both England and Ireland with great frankness, but he oftener spoke about Ireland. He concerned himself so much about the grievances of that country that he wondered how the people of England could complain of any. My regard for him continued to the very last time he was with me. I then advised him not to remain in this country. That's quite a key line. I know of a Lady Edward Fitzgerald, who had once been called Pamela, having her property in France, which the said Edward Fitzgerald could never recover. I had opportunities of knowing this circumstance from the lady with whom Pamela had been brought up. It had been intended to sell this property. This is all that appears in the Dublin version of the trial. But if you scour the press, there is additional cross-questioning that gives away additional material. This is the cross question. I won't read all of this. But from Mr. O'Connor said that if he should be obliged to leave the kingdom, he must form some connections for the purpose of getting away, which he would not wish to form. Again, I think there's some radical intent given away there. He believed that he might have met the prisoner, Mr. Binns, at some public meeting, but no acquaintance with him. He never knew Mr. O'Connor under a fictitious name. He never met any man in his life who so much reprobated the idea of any party in this country desiring French assistance. The Attorney General objected to this answer being given, but Mr. Sheridan said he'd been guilty. He said he had been guilty of a most unpardonable neglect in not mentioning the circumstance before. He never saw any change in Mr. O'Connor's political conduct, except that of his being driven from his own country and friends and his endeavouring to go abroad. Okay, so perhaps the first element to note, if we go back to the substance of the speech bubble, is that Gilray is spot on. It's a summary, but the summary is pretty close. And he's assisted in this by the decision of some newspapers to reprint testimony by the leading Whigs at the trial, including Sheridan's, verbatim, straight after O'Connor's revelations come out. So that this is in the public mind, not only when it happens, but also after O'Connor's testimony. And this is the Sun newspaper's broader commentary on this. Arthur O'Connor's account of himself says the Sun is very modest. He states that he was a member of the executive directory. He'd been a United Irishman from 1796 and a member of the directory until January 1798, and began his communications with France in the year 1796. It goes on, it may not be amiss when we are thus officially and upon the most incontrovertible evidence put into possession of the real history of this gentleman to compare the character of him as drawn by the opposition. After having been told, as Lord Holland called it, honourably acquitted, without drawn by the report. I'm comparing Arthur O'Connor's testimony with the original testimony from the Whigs of the trial. Back to Sheridan's original testimony, I think we can say that Sheridan's statement goes beyond a simple declaration of trust in character. It shows that Sheridan had unreservedly discussed Irish politics with this high-ranking United Irishman, and that he'd gone as far as suggesting that he leave England, presumably for O'Connor's safety, to escape potential arrest in Britain. So, moving on. Beyond this celebrated court case, which saw the Whigs involved in a courtroom scuffle, and there are rumours about the level of Sheridan's involvement here. Vincent O'Toole really goes to town on this in his book, and I won't discuss that in detail. I think its significance points to an important thread in Sheridan's speeches in 1798, his political speeches in 1798, which acts as a counterpoint to the speech that Robert referred to on the need to defend against the French invasion. The arrest of Arthur O'Connor is the link to Sheridan's concern with the suspension of habeas corpus. He does care about it more broadly. It doesn't just appear with the arrest of O'Connor, but it is that linking point during the early part of 1798, and Irish politics more broadly. And if the 1816 edition of speeches is trusted for 1798, much of this dimension is ends up being missing. In the debate on 26th of April on traitorous correspondence and preparations for invasion, Sheridan makes it clear his unwillingness to back the suspension of habeas corpus in Ireland. He took occasion to remark, he took occasion to remark that the period when this measure was before introduced was when a set of persons were ready to be put upon their trial. The same was precisely the case now, meaning the O'Connor brothers, Roger O'Connor as well. But even at that period, there was more abundant reason for the House to adopt such a measure than at the present. The motion against suspension of habeas corpus, and Roberts hinted at this, was defeated by 183-5. Sheridan's take on the Irish crackdown put him in a very small minority of five. Now, the broader significance of this intervention in terms of Whig politics was demonstrated in another extra parliamentary speech, this time a proper one that one would imagine would appear in our collection, this time in the Whig Club on Tuesday, the 2nd of May, at the Freemasons Tavern, around about the 2nd of May, I haven't checked this, 2 weeks before O'Connor's trial. I'll read just some very, very minor bits of this. I managed to get toasting in this at the very beginning. Mr. Sheridan's health being drank with loud applause, he rose and expressed his regret that his learned friend should decline delivering his sentiments on account of the suspension of the Habeas Corpus Act. And that's a reference to Erskine not backing Sherrod on Habeas Corpus. Mr. Fox had delivered an excellent speech against the foreign enemy and against the common enemy, Mr. Pitt, but he thought his learned friend Erskine might also have ventured to deliver his opinions. In defiance of incarceration, he would speak out and tell the people their situation while anything like liberty of speech and of the press remained. We may risk the pillory, but we ought to risk it. Applause. And you can see, again, we discussed this yesterday, the way in which opinion not only in the Commons, but also in the Whig Club appears in these speeches. We have laughter and applause later on. If I can skip downwards a little further to the laughter and applause bit. Ministers in power and constituting them the Directory of Great Britain, that's what gets the laugh. Insinuations have been thrown out that he did not act with Mr. Fox in what he lately said in the House of Commons. Certainly he did not consult with Mr. Fox, nor had any communication with him on the subject. But he well knew what had been heard that day, that on the question of reform and on the necessity of repelling a foreign enemy, Mr. Fox agreed with him in opinion. Some might think retirement the best step, and that Mr. Sheridan might think public calls on the people. I think there's a grammatical error there. I give them credit for their motives, let them give me credit for mine, but we're all unanimous in refusing any assistance from France. By taxation and violating our liberties, ministers are driving the country to revolution. The corruption of persons in power led people ever to consider whether anything worse could be introduced by the French. But notwithstanding that corruption, he could not bear to see society ripped up and destroyed. But there is as much private worth, humanity, honest dealing and charity in this country as ever prevailed in any place. Applause. Whatever we may act, we all mean the same thing, the re-establishment of liberty, and Mr. Sheridan concluded by giving us toast, our absent friend, the Habeas Corpus Act. Erskine then responds on the Habeas Corpus Act that, this is Erskine, he was as much determined as any man to speak out, notwithstanding the suspension of the Habeas Corpus Act, but he saw no good purpose to the delivery of his opinions that day in a convivial meeting that could answer, especially as his words might be misrepresented. So that's why Erskine doesn't want to talk about Habeas Corpus in the Whig meeting, so not only in Parliament, but in the private-ish Whig meeting. But one of the interesting things about this Whig club speech is that, just as in the Commons, these club speeches also have variants. Some with quite significant differences. For example, in another report, the response by Erskine said that, quote, after what he'd seen of the conduct of government to his noble friend, the Duke of Norfolk, and that's a reference to the Duke of Norfolk getting into trouble after toasting to Our Majesty the people, in noticing so strongly a sentiment given by him in a crucial moment, he thought it prudent, says Erskine, in so large a meeting, when the sentiments of gentlemen were frequently misrepresented out of doors, now to abstain from giving it any further declaration of his own opinions on a subject so often agitated. So essentially, Erskine's not going to risk toasting a highly charged political opinion. And this leads to the second point, which is that there are issues around the publication of club utterances that make them perhaps in some ways the same, but in other ways a little different to speeches in the Commons. Firstly, the drunkenness of those present, although there's a fair amount of drunkenness in the House of Commons as well. Secondly, the deliberate preparation of text for the press, and not necessarily reflecting what was said on the occasion, again, though that did happen in Commons terms. And thirdly, the involvement of certain pressmen in a very explicit fashion in both party politics and club culture. This is much more explicit in Ireland in the early 19th century when it comes to the Daniel O'Connell's movement, when in almost every single O'Connellite movement there's a pressman there, he's mentioned, and the relationship between newspaper and speech making is much tighter. But I think there are indications of that starting here. The second issue is the obvious differences in emphasis. Sheridan was playing to a different audience, and so he was placing greater stress on his differences with government. He was also pointedly noting that some of his fellow Whigs were not backing him on the issue, Erskine most notably. The True Briton, when printing the Run the Whig Club speech, compared his common speech on an invasion, quote, appears to us to attain the summit of meanness and inconsistency. So the press are aware of the different personas that Sheridan is showing in club and in Parliament. Okay, I've just got a few brief points before concluding on some other speeches. These are internal House of Commons speeches, but I think they again say a little bit more about the consistencies in Sheridan's political position in this very in his revolutionary year. Sheridan came back to O'Connor in a Commons debate of 7th of May, again another debate that doesn't appear in the 1816 collection. I won't go through this at all, but I'll just tell you that the clear themes here are the lack of a genuine radical threat, according to Sheridan, the heavy-handed legal measures enacted by Pitt's government, and the continued presumption on Sheridan's part of O'Connor's innocence. So though the trial is a celebrated event, it's clear that Sheridan went out of his way to trumpet O'Connor's innocence much of the way through the spring of 1798, in a number of places, both inside and outside of Parliament. Another speech occurs on the 11th of June. This one's crucial because it's after the rebellion has started. So major rebellion has occurred in Ireland. Sheridan is back to Parliament and still protesting the ways in which particularly Roger O'Connor, but I think implicitly the O'Connor brothers have been treated by government. There's at least three different versions of this speech that I've found to date of varying lengths, and it focuses primarily on the legal process used to arrest Roger O'Connor. Notwithstanding the suspension of habeas corpus, Sheridan is saying that the due process of arrest had to be followed. Just a brief quote, he had no hesitation in saying it ought not to pass, as nothing could justify, Sheridan says, even at the present crisis, the imprisonment of men on common rumour. And that one of the interesting things about these speeches is that although Fintan O'Toole tries to hammer home the connection between Sheridan and O'Connor and Sheridan's deep involvement in the United Irish conspiracy, whatever you might think of that line, if you'd looked more in more detail at some of Sheridan's speeches in the press, he would have probably given himself more ammunition, of a different type, but ammunition nevertheless. Finally, to finish with O'Connor exposed. In October 1798, the True Briton gleefully noted, Mr. Sheridan, it is said, treats the subject of opposition testimonies at Maidstone with his usual good humour, and means to make the whole business the foundation of a dramatic work, which is to be brought forward under the title of Declarations a Farce. The Whig leadership was humiliated, and yet, I would say the O'Connor case is revealing in a number of ways. Firstly, it's an illustration of the way in which parliamentary oratory was part of a much broader public sphere. It cannot be understood without looking at the companionate speeches in clubs and societies, and it was thought by contemporaries to have impact. As one Pittite newspaper put it after O'Connor's confession, quote, have they not by their speeches in Parliament most uniformly as well as violently reproached the executive government of Great Britain and Ireland for those measures which they took to repress rebellion? It continued, could the conspirators then have had a more convenient ally than Mr. Fox has been to them by means of his speeches in Parliament? What they wanted was an orator whose speeches might be made public, who had already a stage on which he could act, who under shelter of his privilege of Parliament might utter with impunity accusations against the King's ministers, such as might freely circulate under the sanction of his great name, and who, by this inflaming the people to madness, might prepare them generally for rebellion by means of the calumnies against the government. Interesting that the mention of the protection of parliamentary privilege there, which is why clearly Erskine is a little bit more concerned about saying these things in the Whig Club. The Times said that Fox, Sheridan and their colleagues in their, quote, speeches in Parliament as well as in the Whig Club, an entire quote, were delivering the words of Mr. O'Connor. Secondly, this brief trawl through a selection of lesser known Sheridan speeches can illuminate aspects of what this project is trying to achieve. O'Connor appears as the linchpin in Sheridan's speeches on habeas corpus and more broadly the legal treatment of political radicals. The speeches between April and June testified to Sheridan's very singular voice, sometimes only one of five, to his also to his obdurate concern with certain topics, and in this most tumultuous of years, his unstinting concern with the liberty of the subject.
Time, but I think do we have 5 minutes or so?
Yeah, I think so. People might have to gobble their lunch.
Questions for Robert Kamal about the project. I don't know if Robert, do you want to
talk?
Sorry.
Danny.
First
of all, this is such a fantastic project. It raises so many interesting questions. I'm curious what you're planning on doing with the problem of performance. Like, I'd always found, you know, like the square bracket applause, not, it doesn't quite do it for me. And I'm wondering what you want, like, are you thinking that in the introduction you may actually have a discussion of the nature of that applause or the kind of improvisation that Sheridan would quite regularly, indulge in, the way that he would exemplify someone sitting near him or, you know, point to someone across the way, like all these things that are in some of the, I know in some of the newspaper accounts, they're signaled, right? They're present. And they tried to do a little bit of that in the Burke edition, but it doesn't quite work. And I'm wondering if you thought that through at all.
I think that the introduction will need to have a lengthy discussion about the nature of the commons and the way in which it is used as a particular space. And that space is marked in something. Burke and Sheridan talk about the gentleman under the clock, don't they? Or the gentleman in the blue ribbon. Mm-hmm. And there's the ways in which the space is inhabited that are imagined to be or hoped to be inexplicable to the original readers of those reports. So we need to talk about that. But we'd like the project to be a kind of multi-platform one, of which the most traditional and the most prestigious in some senses is the edition, but we would like to one of our plans is to record people who have an interest in the topic that Sheridan is speaking about to perform them. And while we can't recreate the applause, we can sort of think about the way in which their speeches are performed. And
how deliverable are some of these speeches in their written form, and what relationship might that text that survives have with the oratory that was possible on a particular occasion?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's what we can do. I mean, it's very difficult. I mean, it's sort of like anything, any form of performance is capturing it when you only have print or handwritten accounts, so it's going to be very difficult. So also, there's no guarantee that the applause was there when it's said to have been there. You know, that those texts are creating an occasion for particular, the recording of it is interested as well as interesting.
But the online supplement's a great idea, I guess.
Yeah, and I want to follow up from what Danny's talking about the problems of the affordances of print versus the kind of possibilities of the digital. Mm-hmm. And I want to come back to the kind of aside of, we're going to regularize the spelling of names even though we know they're significant or potentially interesting. When technologically, I don't think you need to in a digital surrogate, and I don't know that the print requires it. Am I wrong?
I think that with the two examples I gave, you could easily search for those. But I think that OUP, who have will want a stand, are currently in a modern spelling phase. It is a phase that people go through, like other things. I think that the search, the online version, most of their scholarly texts online are in modern spelling. The exception would be the Win Stanley edition, where the editors argue very strongly for old spelling. But I'm not. Given that old spelling isn't maintained by everybody, even in the past, I'm not sure what we'll do with that. But I think it's not a debate which we've closed our minds on, because actually we don't really start doing this project until the 1st of July.
I know it will become clear.
Well, I do have a quick follow-up, which is the question of how much does OUP's standards and best practices determine both the format of the print and the digital versions of this project, and how much say do you?
We have some say, but I think there's also that
we had say in our pitch, and then obviously there was a response
sure,
to our
sure,
pitch,
sure.
And
yeah.
We modified our say to a degree because obviously the contract's important. And
sure.
What has caused most debate, right, is when we've discussed with Sheridan scholars leaving out some of the speeches because they said, oh, yeah, that's fine. And OEP thought that was fine. When we suggested the project to the AHRC, their reviewers went absolutely bananas over it and said this is little more than a selected edition.
That was also one we were trying to build them for £1 million, though. That might have influenced that.
One of the interesting the different version of the project that went to the Leverhulme was that it suddenly we'd forgotten about that claim, which had once seemed so up to us, so important to sort of capture a kind of integrity, selection. So that's, we certainly think that the website can have every occasion when he spoke, because some of the times he speaks at the Crown and Anchor Tavern, for example,
mm-hmm.
we might know he spoke, but have no record of him, what he said. We might have that he toasted, you know, there might be a record of audience response, record of toasting, but no substantial record of what was said. But it seems important that an elite politician was at the Crown and Anchor talking about something is in itself worthy of record. So I think that there's lots of, we'll have to see how it goes in some ways.
One of the most frustrating things that I've found in the last few months looking at Sheridan's speeches, primarily not from the edition but in the press, is the number of times Mr. Sheridan explained that and those words appear. What does he explain? we're not given that. But so there's going to be more than we can ever produce in the project.
I think we might have to leave it there for now, but I'm sure we can continue the discussion of the fascinating project over lunch, but we'll be looking at it.